So I will be talking about next generation interfaces for exploiting workflows. And as this is a workshop, right, I put in a lot of discussion points that we could later grab on. But I will really move quickly over the talk. So really quick, climate weather workflows, they can be considered as a directed acyclic graph. And inside this graph, there are certain stages, like this stage over here, that is repeated several times. For example, for every month, you try to do compute similar, you run a similar computation and you kind of generate a similar output at the end. So you repeat this stage maybe hundreds of times. So the software the scientists are using, developed by Met Office, is called Silk because it deals with those kind of cyclic workflows. And the scientists, they specify the tasks, which are the commands, represented by commands to run. For example, they run here post-processing task, and they specify these dependencies. What we don't see in this graph is any kind of I/O dependencies. We really just see virtually the dependencies between tasks. Once the scientists have specified such a workflow configuration file and these commands or scripts they want to run, they give it to this Silk tool and say, run this workflow. Silk generates, for instance, for the workload manager Slurm, a bunch of individual job scripts. Those job scripts are then managed by Slurm, which then runs the application. And there is, as I said, pretty much no dependency stored in terms of data. The only dependency is between the jobs, which is implicit. And those jobs then run on our data center where we have the different types of nodes. It may actually go to different facilities across different data centers, such a more complicated workflow. But a single workflow normally runs in one data center. And in the data center, we move towards the era where we have heterogeneous storage. So we see a lot of burst buffers. We have still tape, but we have different tiers with different storage characteristics. And one such an application, so that means one task here in this diagram, for example, the model run, may use a deep stack, I/O stack, involving, for example, the XIOS, which is a domain-specific, I would say, in-memory burst buffer, so to speak. And we have NetCDF and so on. Within the EasyWays project, we have also developed ESDM, the Earth System Data Middleware, which plugs in at the layer of NetCDF and then kind of replaces the underlying stack here to make use of such a heterogeneous storage landscape. Now, this is a little bit of background where this project comes from. Now let's look a bit more beyond the scope of the climate and weather domain and talk a bit about data centers. So when I run a project in a data center, I have to typically to submit a proposal. As a scientist, I say, I need this time, I need this GPU and CPU hours, this storage space. But once I get these resources granted, I can do whatever I want, right? I mean, of course I have quota and compute limits now in place, but as a data center, I typically don't track what the scientist is doing. So the scientists can virtually do whatever they want. And if the CPU hours are not sufficient, they can request more, right? But the problem is, right, that the data center doesn't know what the users are doing. And another problem is that we are still using tools in HPC that are 40 years old, I would say. Like batch systems are pretty old. And I'm often envy, provokingly, if I look at CERN, the Large Hadron Collider, and other big experiments, how these physicists, how they are doing such a detailed planning of activities and that it actually works, right? Where in our, you know, in HPC systems, scientists just log in, they fire up jobs sometimes and they work as this would be a PC, right? But instead they run it on thousands of nodes, they run a job. And yeah, this surprises me sometimes. And I believe that we could do a bit more having this understanding of workflows in terms of planning of our HPC resources. So in an alternate universe, this is, like I said, a provoking part here, the scientists could deliver this workflow orchestration. So this is my workflow. It has this and this little steps. Or what it does, it delivers the containers of all the softwares, and it tells us what kinds of data management plan we need. What is the data life cycle of all the data products we produce? It also tells us something about the time constraints. I want to have my paper ready next month, for example. The data must be ready for next month for my paper or my budget, maybe, right? And then I could give this to the data center and developer that they could simulate the execution before such a workflow is actually executed in practice. And they could estimate the cost, the energy consumption, and whatever target goals they have. And then they could see, is this the best option to run? So what storage do I need, for example? And what on which part of the machine? Sometimes I have, you know, different CPU types and so on. This should run. And ultimately, then they could say, okay, it's a good idea to run this on my data center. Or they could say, oh, maybe, you know, the workload isn't well suited for this particular hardware that we have. Go to another data center, right? They are our friends. We collaborate. I think that fits really well, this idea of federalism and having different, you know, sites, tier two and tier three sites. Okay. Once we have this workflow, also the systems, they could exploit the information and orchestrate the I/O and the computation, making better decision data location and placement. And we could also trade the computation versus storage and energy costs versus the runtime. Having all this in mind, still meeting the needs of the scientists to deliver something at a certain you know, deadline. And I think, you know, big data technology is here much further away, and they have done a better job than we've done in HPC, where we still everything is possible, but you have to do it manually pretty much. And this brings me to my personal vision that I always put up as a slide on this workshop here, that I believe for intelligent storage systems and interfaces, right, that we have abstract data interfaces with enhanced data management capabilities, and we really integrate compute and storage, that is not a separate, you know, entity. They really belong together to some extent, because to optimize a workflow, you can't just optimize compute. You can't just optimize storage. You have to have both things in your mind to get it a best kind of price performance out of it, right? You want to look at data in different, you know, with different views. You may have want to look at your data as a file system perspective, right? You want to browse. This is the directory that I've created. I want to at the same time to look at it as a database, maybe, right? I want to say, you know, I want to fire up a SQL query, and maybe I want to look at it like an HTML5 file, right? And there's a different, all these different ways, but at the same time, it should all go to the same data. This is nowadays, I think, pretty much possible in the big data world, where you can access seamlessly CSV files and stuff like that with SQL queries, for instance, right? So we have this kind of abstraction, but in HPC, we are not there. And then under the hood, we have the storage systems, they should be smarter, right? They should be self-aware, they should know their performance, and then they should, so they have their performance characteristics, and each device that you plug in basically brings their own performance model, so brings your own behavior, and when the behavior doesn't match the expectation, the system administrator should be notified about it, right? And also the way we organize data, what this model's in place, the system should know, okay, based on this model, it's smart to use store data here or there, or at the same time do this and this. And also this whole kind of idea should work across sites in the cloud. So basically, you have this kind of living organism. Here is some new compute power, some new storage capacity. You plug it in, the system says, oh, that's great. Let's make use of it. And I understand how to make use of it based on this model. That's what I call intelligent storage. And it's that's why it's in the vision part. It's not yet there. Okay, now let's get back a little bit more on Earth, how we could actually exploit workflow knowledge in a project like in EasyWays. So what we need to do for the scientists, or want to achieve in EasyWays, is we want to enhance this workflow description with I/O characteristics. Like what input do you need, and if you generate output, what is the characteristics of the output you generate? How long do we want to keep the data? What is the data life cycle? So that means we move towards having an explicit input I/O definition the dependencies instead of having them implicitly by just the tasks which are presented to you. And then we combine this idea with having smarter I/O scheduling so that the system could understand what hardware and software is in place. And then once you understand, you know, the workflow and you understand their capabilities, then you make this mapping. How do you place data? How do you transfer data? How do you migrate data? How do you stage, replicate, and allocate data? And then again, you could also use data compression and data recomputation. Instead of storing data explicitly, you just reenact part of the workflow. And if we have this in place, we achieve a separation of concern where the scientists really can deal with what they know well. Sometimes they don't know, but it's another story. They should know the workflow and the I/O behavior. And then the system should map this hardware using expert knowledge and machine learning to the underlying hardware. And that means, hopefully, as a scientist, you have to define your workflow only once, and then you are performance portable across the different systems you have. Here's an example of an extended workflow definition where we have still the tasks, but instead of just saying, you know, this task depends on this task and so on, we have here the inputs annotated, and we have also information about the outputs, how they are produced. And then we have again the cyclic behavior here. And how we could make use of it, here's just an example. For data placement. So consider we have three file systems, local file system, node local file system, like slash DMP, for instance, scratch file system shared, and a work file system shared, but with different characteristics. And now if you look for a single data set, you have to make the decision where to place the data. You could say, for example, I generate my data on the local file system, I do something with it, and at some point I migrate it to the work file system, and there it's read multiple times, and then at some point I delete both instances pretty much at the same time. For the redundancy reason, I might like to have a copy, a replica still. I may also decide to put it on scratch. I may, you know, do any kind of combination. And this kind of placement is typically done by the users manually, which is tedious, and of course it's often suboptimally, in particular when you think about where should I place here data product 2 and data product 3, right? Maybe if you say for in all the time I want to store this data product on the same file systems like work, but maybe what you want to have is that depending on the cycle you are in, you change the storage location. Maybe you want to change it depending on the usage, performance characteristics of the system, and so on. So it's really a complicated decision. But the key idea is really that the scheduler, an I/O scheduler kind of, and system-aware I/O scheduler should make those kind of decisions, and also, if needed, migrate the data on behalf of the user. So let me now quickly talk a little bit more about ESDM. So it's part of the EasyWays project. It integrates as NetCDF backend, but it's also a middleware by its own, so you can use the API by itself. We address the inhomogeneous storage stack by allowing to store data at multiple storage systems. So when you write one data set, part of the data set can be on one storage backend, and at the same time, another part can be on another storage backend, for example. So you can split, like one file can reside on multiple storages at the same time. And it's configured in a file how to make this kind of mapping. It should deal with scalable data management practice, and it's basically for dealing with large runs and make them really highly efficient. So I have here an example of a new application where you can consider, well, I have a compute time step, I do this n times, right? The application n times computes something, and then it wants to do some I/O in an I/O time step, I would call it. Normally, what scientists are doing, they start I/O after they have computed this n times, have done this computation, then they start this I/O time step asynchronously, and then they may have a remote server that drains the data by pulling it from all the client nodes. But the problem is always, when you have done this manipulation in memory and you read the data again, you basically waste memory bandwidth because you have to read the data once more, right? That's a price to pay. So what we've done now I currently have prototyped is with ESDM is a streaming. So basically imagine you do it n minus one times to compute the time step, but the last time you want to compute, every time you have computed one value, you append this value immediately to a buffer. And then basically you save this additional memory read because it's still cached. And once this buffer is big enough, you would then apply kind of transformation that you need to do to the data to make it ready to be shipped directly to the storage. And once this buffer is full, basically fire it off. So if the hardware supports it most efficiently, that would mean basically you can save all this additional memory costs for the I/O. And here's an example from a shallow water model that has been adjusted for it. It was a column-based model, so that we have here a matrix, which is a 2D matrix. And the original code, what it did, it went over the X axis and dumped pretty much a column out. Okay, so therefore, for every time you write something out with netcdf, well, it had to call ncputvarafloat, writing down one of these columns, right? Because they are contiguous in memory. Okay, with ESDM, now we start such a write request. We define the domain that we want to write, and then we can basically create a 2D loop if we want, and say, okay, every time we have this data point ready, we would just pack it into this buffer directly. And then once we are done, we commit the request. And like I said, what ESDM can decide is every time we pack a value into this buffer, once the buffer is full enough, we can do already some I/O. We can fire off some I/O asynchronously. We don't have to wait until the commit, but the commit point is the kind of a synchronization point. After this point, the I/O has been, and we can reuse all the data. Good, so that was a little kind of outlook what we are currently doing. And now for the workflow extensions that we are planning to implement, we are dealing with an ESDM I/O scheduler as a very high level, probably a Python component. And this engaged with the current way the workflow is working with Silk by providing a I/O configuration workflow separately, and then this scheduler can load the ESDM configuration in which we store information about the organization in memory, organization of storage systems that we have in our data center. And the scheduler is called by Silk to make decisions in terms of priorities. Okay, so this allows the scheduler to say, okay, we have different paths that we can follow in our acyclic graph, job graph, task graph, but it might be good to run those jobs together and first this job and then this job, because then we may store the data locally and there is no additional communication needed and there's no shared file system, for example. All those decisions, they can be made here, and the way it works together is very simple. By really Silk will provide all the information that it has about the current task to the scheduler, and the scheduler then reads these configuration files and can make the decision how to place the data. This information gets injected as a file name, a fake file name, pseudo file name, into the file name. The file name then is kind of given to the application. The app uses ESDM, and ESDM gets this information again from this fake file name. What it should do, it can still say, oh, it's not possible because there's no storage space, but it should obey this kind of hint, and then it kind of makes the decision. So the system information in ESDM is stored in a configuration file that is very simple. But what we have here is like we have different targets configured. We have give them names like work one, work two, and temp, which is a local file system. We can give a little performance model, which is very lightweight at the moment, but it will grow more sophisticated over time. But what we have already, which is quite turned out to be quite useful, is that we say how many threads per node should you run the application with to get good performance, how many threads maximum globally should you use, because like in DKLZ, they have for example 100 servers, and you know that once you have more than 200 IO threads running, well, it's not anymore, you don't get more performance. So if 1,000 nodes all doing IO with the IO servers, but you have only 100 IO servers, you don't need to have 10 threads for each IO, for each client. You just have 1,000 clients, each uses one thread to do the IO, and you get still the perfect performance. That's basically what this configuration tells us. And this information is, like I said, read from the EOS scheduler. And the extended workflow description that we have in mind is that you have to specify the inputs for a task. What are the files? Some of these files, they could be on a shared file system. Some of them can be ESDM files. Some of them can depend on a cycle information. So it's like the I generate a file in cycle one, but I need it in cycle three, for example, to verify some data. But for the outputs, we have to give more information. But what information to integrate is not yet perfectly clear, because basically the scientists must be able to specify it. Okay. Sometimes scientists know, oh, my data will be 100 gigabyte. Sometimes they know something about the dimensions of the data that will be generated, and they know the data type is float, but sometimes they don't know either. But again, what we think is that when we that we are able to monitor the behavior of such a workflow, and then you can generate and infer such a file and give it to the user, and the user says, oh, now I understand what is the IO behavior, and then the system can learn from it and actually use it in the long term. Yeah, and then the IO scheduler should provide these hints for this co-locating of the tasks, like should I run the tasks on the same nodes again? Should I place the data on which file system, shared work file system? And we want to also combine this with IME. IME allows you to pin data into the burst buffer such that it is not drained to the backend storage, and to kind of stage it into the burst buffer. This is kind of also ongoing activity. Yeah, and this is planned for EasyWays. But we, in EasyWays, we try to do the down on earth possible things of this kind of vision that I presented to you. Okay. Another kind of activity that I say every time we have this workshop is the next generation interfaces activity. It has slowed down a little bit, or considerably. The goal of this activity was that we wanted to get basically a new data-driven compute storage APIs, where we deal with workflows and metadata as first-class citizens, where we approach this idea of heterogeneous environments, different vendors, and that we have smarter software and hardware instead of, you know, these manual configurations. And it should be, you know, the software should be improving over time, self-aware and learning, which I mentioned, and that we have interfaces beyond Spark or whatever you. And the idea was to establish a forum similar to MPI, which is vendor agnostic, having experts from data centers, research, industry, steering boards, and so on, based cases to really get on with the standard. What has happened? As an approach, we decided to say, well, we wanted to develop a set of white papers that describe the limitations of the current state of practice. We describe the visions, and we select use cases and community approaches. Ultimately, we get more community on board. We have then last year, December 2018, started to write a course paper where some people have contributed. We then decided to split the paper into smaller sub-papers that are easier to manage. Still, it turned out to be really difficult to pull the community together, because there is basically no funding involved. in this activity. So the commitment of individuals that we had and have, well, the time commitment basically are typically overruled by other activities. The good news is, though, we had the birth of a feather for ISC 20 accepted, but as I said, ISC will be virtual. But I still believe that this is a good approach and that, you know, this community-driven development is really what we need in storage instead of having particular solutions and vendor-specific solutions. And I hope, you know, that someone has interest to help out and push a little bit further to make this undead NGI activity live again. Okay, to sum up the goals of our visions and design, I think it's still important that we have a separation of concern between developers, users, and system optimization, that the scientists provide these workflow descriptions and the IO characteristics, the system exploits these workflow specifications, knowing the hardware specifications. And I showed you also that with the IO middleware, we kind of try to go towards this. And well, with ESDM, we are luckily in this EasyWays 1 and EasyWays 2 project to have an important domain of climate and weather applications. Just as an outlook, I believe if we know this information about workflows, it's really visual because we can do the performance modeling by a simulation or taking the recorded behavior. And if we had even the compute models, right, you can really understand how long the workflow runs, how much cost will it have to run on a given platform, including Amazon and so on. And you can do a lot of what-if analysis, right? What should be my system like to really support this workflow best, most efficiently? And in a far distant future, right, I wished personally that when I approach a data center and say, I want to do some computation, right, some science, the data center says, well, don't tell me about the CPU hours or whatever. Just give me your workflow specification file. I give them the workflow specification file and they tell me, yeah, that's great. A great fit to our infrastructure. We can run this for you. And this is what you need, right? Instead of that, I have to sit down and say, I need 100,000 CPU hours or what have you. And I don't even understand what hardware they have fully, right? So that's basically the idea. And that concludes my talk. And